A normal day out for a farmer and his daughter in Seneca, Illinois, quickly turned into something more disturbing. Upon inspecting what they believed to be a dead deer at the side of the road, the pair discovered the body of a deceased woman. This is the case of Grundy County Jane Doe. On October 2, 1976, the body of a young woman was found lying in a ditch alongside U.S. Route 6 near Holderman Hill in unincorporated Seneca, Illinois. The body was discovered when a farmer and his daughter who were passing through the area approached what they believed to be the body of a deer beside the road. This woman had not only been murdered, but she was also nameless and became known as Grundy County Jane Doe or Jane Seneca Doe. Jane Doe was a young black woman between the ages of 15 and 27 years old. She stood at 5'7 and weighed 150 pounds. She had black hair, brown eyes, and a scar on her right hip. She also had what appeared to be either a scar or a birthmark on her lower abdomen. At the time of discovery, Jane Doe was primarily nude, leading investigators to believe she may have been sexually assaulted. The only clothing on Jane Doe was a red, black, and white cardigan that had been wrapped around her head. The cardigan had also been covered by a green plastic bag secured with electrical tape. It was determined that Jane Doe had only been deceased for a few days before her body was discovered, and she had been killed by a gunshot wound to the back of her head with a .38 caliber revolver.
Prior to filming this video, I was able to confirm through the Grundy County Deputy Chief Coroner, Brandon Johnson, that some details that had been listed in some reports but missing in others were indeed true. These details include that a bottle of TJ Swan wine was found in the cardigan pocket. In addition to this, there was a partial tag discovered inside the cardigan containing the numbers 3319 and a price of $15.99. With no clues to her identity and no leads to her murder, Jane Doe was buried on Thanksgiving Day, 1976. Now, many times Jane and John Doe's fall to the wayside. Investigators may have no leads to follow. Cases may be so old that sufficient evidence for testing either wasn't collected or has degraded past testability. And there often isn't a large public outcry for perseverance in the cases. It is all too common that a Jane or John Doe may be buried and mostly forgotten for decades before finding their identity. And that's if they ever discover their true identity in the first place. Thankfully for Grundy County Jane Doe, she does have someone on her side continuing to search for her identity all these years later.
Brandon Johnson is the current Deputy Chief Coroner of Grundy County, and he is the point of contact for Jane Doe's case. He has been working hard on overturning any possible clues as to her identity. He currently runs the Who Was Jane Seneca Doe Facebook page, where he continues to tell Jane Doe's story while also sharing the stories and information of other missing and unidentified people. In 2018, Brandon Johnson had Jane Doe's body exhumed. The body was sent to the University of North Texas Center for Human Identification, where a DNA profile for Jane Doe was developed. The DNA was entered into CODIS, a nationwide DNA database, but no matches were found. When no matches were found through CODIS, a new possibility was opened up by an organization called DNA Doe Project. DNA Doe Project is a group that has worked with investigative agencies to help uncover the identities of multiple Jane and John Does. They helped discover the identity of Belle in the Well, a case that has been previously covered on this channel. They've helped to reunite multiple victims with their true names.
These continued efforts to reveal Jane Doe's identity have paid off with a familial DNA match, which was discovered by the DNA Doe Project. The relatives discovered through this match have been helpful in continuing to search for Jane Doe's identity. Through these family members, we now know more about Jane Doe than ever before.
She was likely missing in October of 1976. Her parents may have been from Selma, Alabama. One set of her grandparents may also be from Selma, Alabama. One set of her grandparents may have had the last name of Calhoun. One great-grandparent's last name may have been Harris. Other places possibly containing relatives include Dallas and Wilcox counties in Alabama, and possibly the state of Ohio, where one branch of the family had moved. She may have siblings who are unaware of her existence. It has been stated by Brandon Johnson that he believes there's a good chance that most of Jane Doe's relatives simply don't know about her, which has made identifying her more difficult. Since the discovery of Grundy County Jane Doe, the following people have been ruled out as potential matches: Leary and Barry Stalling, who went missing in 1960 from Columbus, Mississippi. Jennifer Joyce Barton, who went missing in 1976 from Austin, Texas. Susan Redding, who went missing in 1975 from Seattle, Washington. Those investigating Jane Doe's case in Grundy County continue to put flowers where her body was found so many decades ago. There are currently fingerprints and DNA both on file to help with identifying Jane Doe.
With so little information pertaining to both Jane Doe's identity and what happened to her, there are very few theories to discuss. Now, it is possible that Jane Doe had been murdered by someone she knew, possibly via domestic violence, which is why her face was covered and she hasn't been claimed by anyone. She may have also been murdered by a stranger who was taking advantage of someone who may not have known the area well and needed help. When it comes to the cardigan wrapped in a plastic bag around her head, I personally believe that it was a measure to prevent blood evidence being left behind when Jane Doe's body was moved from wherever she had been killed to where she had been discovered.
The piece of evidence that intrigued me most was the cardigan. Thanks to the help of some sleuths on the internet, I was able to discover that the number 46571 on a cloth tag could be an FTC registration number, which led to an Allen Originals Incorporated. This was a business registered with the Small Business Administration in 1972, and records indicate that the company involuntarily petitioned for bankruptcy in 1979, according to the New York Times archives. The address listed for the company was in New York City, but I wasn't able to find any other information about the company besides the fact that they were registered as an importer, manufacturer, wholesaler with the FTC. So, it is likely that this company either made or imported this type of sweater and then sold it to other retailers through wholesale. When considering the price tag on the sweater, a quick search told me that $15.99 in 1976 has the same purchasing power as $72.45 today. Personally, that seems like a pricey sweater to me. So did the sweater belong to Jane Doe? Was it a piece of clothing she had with her when she was murdered and it was simply used by her attacker to prevent the transfer of blood evidence? Or did the sweater belong to the attacker or someone associated with the attacker? Could the further insights on the sweater provide more clues to either Jane Doe's identity or the identity of her murderer?
There is a strong possibility through the diligent efforts of Brandon Johnson and the DNA Doe Project that Grundy County Jane Doe may one day reclaim her name. If you have any information in this case, I would strongly urge you to contact Brandon Johnson, the Grundy County Deputy Chief Coroner, who is in charge of Jane Doe's case. You can reach him at 815-941-3359 or through the email bjohnson@grundyco.org. Now, this contact information will be provided in the description box down below, and there will also be a full list of resources pinned at the top of the comment section below this video. So what are your thoughts on this case? Do you think that we could see success in finding Jane Doe's identity? Do you have any further theories that you might want to discuss? Just let me know in the comment section down below, but as always, please remember to stay respectful. Please help me to continue putting these cases back into the public eye by sharing, whether that be by sharing this video or any of the sources down below. Just please keep sharing. The chances are that someone somewhere knows something important about this case or any other case covered on this channel or any other channel like it. And if we can get the right case seen by the right person, it may be enough to crack a case wide open. But finally, thank you so much for watching today's case, and I will see you all again soon for another.